let's make a deal. You remember that old show, TV show with Monty Hall, where he would come in and these people all over in the audience were dressed real crazy with silly things that they would trade to get something behind or hidden behind one of these curtains, a really big prize, you know, curtain one, two, or three. Well, tonight we're gonna have our own version of Let's Make a Deal. And one of you will be receiving a prize. We have to have a prize if we're gonna have a TV show. So, on with our version of Let's Make a Deal. Let me ask you, is God real?
Yes.
And what's he like? Well, let's look to see what's behind the curtain. I'm saying this is our own version here. Curtain on number one, it's empty. Well, oh, that's for those who don't believe in the existence of God, that he's just a figment of our imagination. Let's see what's behind curtain number two. Unloving, uncaring, unfair. Well, you know, if you're here, maybe you're thinking that God, if God really loved me, I wouldn't be homeless. If he really cared, he wouldn't have let that tragedy happen in my life. And, you know, sometimes it just, he seems unfair because look at all those evil people prospering. And I'm doing good as hard as I can and it just doesn't seem right. Or maybe you know of him and, but he just... he's just someone big up there somewhere, distant and unreachable. A.W. Tozer says that A.W. Tozer said that what comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us. Curtain number three, this is the real God. Glorious, magnificent, good, just, merciful, a loving Father, and much, much more. Which curtain have you selected for your view of God? Although God is invisible, ladies, he's not hiding. He wants to be known. And he doesn't want us to just know that he is real, that he exists, but he wants to be known in a real, intimate, and wonderful way. Jeremiah 29, 13 to 14 says, and this is God speaking, and ye shall seek me and shall find me when you shall search for me with all of your heart, and I will be found by you, saith the Lord. Tonight, I'm going to be talking about curtain number three, the real deal, and how God pulls back the curtain to reveal a glimpse of who he truly is. So what are the ways in which God reveals himself? Well, first, through creation. Look at the vastness of the stars, the immenseness of the oceans, the majesty of a mountain and the Grand Canyon, the complexity of our bodies, the beauty of a sunset or flower, or the frightening force of a lightning bolt. That's God speaking. Just as art reflects the artist, so too does creation reflect our Creator. He's telling us that he's indescribable, that he's intelligent, great, humongous. He's so big and he's in control of everything. He's telling us of his beauty and of his almighty divine power. The heavens truly declare the glory of God. Next, God speaks to us through people. In Hebrews 1, it says, in the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways. He speaks to us through a godly friend, a good preacher, stranger, maybe one of the ladies here, perhaps even through me tonight. And of course, he speaks to us through his word, the Bible. Over and over and over again, the Bible tells us, it has this repeated phrase, that they shall know that I am God. Over and again, 66 times alone in the book of Ezekiel, it says something to that effect. For example, thus will I magnify myself and sanctify myself, and I will be known in the eyes of many nations, and they shall know that I am the Lord. Or Jeremiah 24:7, and I will give them a heart to know me, that I am the Lord, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God. In Isaiah 49:23, and thou shalt know that I am the Lord. But they didn't get it, did they? So God sent Jesus. The same verse in Hebrews 1, in the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us through his Son. And it goes on to say that Jesus is the exact representation of the Father's being, God the Father's being. John 1:14, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. No man has seen God at any time, only the begotten Son. He hath declared him. In other words, Jesus has made the Father known. In his own words, Jesus said to the Father the night before his crucifixion in John 17, listen carefully, I have manifested, or revealed, I have manifested thy name. O righteous Father, the world hath not known thee, but I have known thee, and these have known that thou hast sent me. He's referring to his disciples. And I have declared unto them thy name, and will declare it, that the love wherewith thou hast loved me may be in them, and I in them. And that includes the disciples today, you and me, if you follow him. In ordinary English, Jesus is saying, Holy Father, though the world doesn't know you, I know you, and I have revealed you to my disciples, and I will continue to reveal you to them so that my love may dwell in them, in us, and forever. Next, God speaks to us through circumstances. Going back to Hebrews 1 again, it says in various ways, God uses miracles to display his power and love. He orchestrates events so that he can show us that he's in control. He brings difficulties into our lives to help us understand some aspect of him in a real tangible way. C.S. Lewis says, God whispers to us in our pleasures, speaks to our consciences, but shouts in our pains. It is God's megaphone to a deaf world. God's not hiding, ladies. He's not hiding. We're just not looking, or we're not able to recognize his handiwork. Oftentimes, trials are designed for a purpose, to God, to show us something in a tangible way. For example, how can you know that God is the God of all comfort, as it tells us in 2 Corinthians 1, unless we're hurting? Or how can you know that he'll deliver you from trouble if you're never in need of a rescue? Or how can you know that he's close to the brokenhearted unless your heart is broken? And last but not least, God discloses himself by the Holy Spirit directly into our hearts. Now that's primarily for those who are his disciples, who are in a relationship with him through Jesus, their Savior. Holy Spirit can make his presence known to us in an undeniable, real way. Anyone know what I mean? Raise your hand if you've ever experienced God's presence when you were distraught. Mm-hmm. Or you had an unbelievable sense of the peace that passes all understanding in the midst of unbelievable turmoil. Or how about, have you experienced a miraculous healing of yourself or a loved one? Or an intervention of maybe he prevented a catastrophe, and you knew it was God pulling back the curtain, and you thought that had to be him. Or maybe you even know that he orchestrated all the events in your life so that you would be here. Really? Here? I wish I had time to hear all your stories of how God has divulged himself in a real, tangible, and unmistakable way. Now, sometimes God's revelation is a little bit more subtle. But in retrospect, you look back and you go, wow, that had to be God. How in the world did I ever get through that? I've been a widow for 7 years. I look back and go, there's no way in the world I could be standing up here and with joy and experience the abundant life were it not for God. I know that without a shadow of a doubt. Sometimes God's revelation is a bit more strong and quote-unquote negative. Like that unbelievable sense of guilt when you've sinned and you know it. It's so oppressive at times. That's the Holy Spirit convicting you of sin and saying, you're not right with me, come back, repent. That's what that's for. Sometimes it's a warning. Someone I know recounted this story where they were driving one day and for some unexplainable reason and no apparent reason, they felt compelled to move into the next lane. And as they were going over the hill, here comes a tractor trailer in the very lane they were in. And there would have been no time to avoid a head-on collision. Or sometimes it could be your conscience screaming in the middle of that temptation, don't do it! God knows how to speak to us, ladies. He is very capable of explaining things to us in a way that we can understand and recognize if we're receptive. What does God want us to know? He wants us to know that he does indeed exist. He wants us to know his character, the way he works, his purposes. He wants us to know that he loves us so much that he proved it on the cross by dying. Romans 5:8 says, but God demonstrates his own love toward us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Wow. He wants us to know that he cares for us and that he's there for us. God is our refuge and a very present help in trouble. Psalm 46:1. And of course, he wants us to know what's contained in his holy Bible. Ladies, he wants to know, to be known in an intimate, personal, growing way. He doesn't want to just be known of him or about him. He wants us to know him up close and personal. We know of the president of the United States. We can read about him, but we don't know the person. In the same way, God wants an up close and personal, real relationship, intimate with him. to think that this holy God, the creator of the universe, wants a relationship with me, this speck here, with you and you and each one of us in the entire world, so much that he paid that unbelievable price of sending his son to the cross. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. King David said in Psalm 8, when I consider thy heavens, the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars, which thou hast ordained, what is man that you are mindful of him, the son of man that you visited him? God's revelations are designed to bring us into a love relationship with him. That's why we were made. How does God want to be known? In truth, and nothing but the truth. 1 John 5:20 says, and we know that the Son of God is come and hath given us an understanding that we may know him who is true. Do you believe what God has said in his word? Or do you believe what you want to believe? Behind curtain number two. We all think incorrectly. Remember Tozer's quote. The most important thing about us is what comes to our mind when we think about God. It's important that we not only believe the real God, but believe in the real God, who he says he is. Let me ask you something. Who are you most likely to listen to? Someone, third party description of so-and-so, or that person themselves? Now, you guys are all kind of far away, and so I'm going to pretend I don't know this lady over here, okay, just for demonstration purposes. So, what is your name?
Peggy.
Hi, Peggy. Nice to meet you. Now, I'm going to give you a description of Peggy, and I'm going to block from my mind what I know about her, except from what I've seen tonight, okay? So, Peggy, she's a woman.
Got that one right.
She's Caucasian. She has blonde hair, or at least outwardly. I know that she's a musician and can play the guitar and sing very well because she demonstrated that to us. Let's see, what else? She's married because I see a wedding ring. I could try to play Sherlock Holmes and be very, very observant, but we're not going to, I think you get the point. Now, this is not going to work because I was thinking I was going to pick someone that was here homeless. So, how am I going to figure this out? Can we pretend that you're homeless?
Okay.
I know that you're also homeless because you're here. Now, this is where my opinion and assumptions are going to sneak in here. Now, don't get upset. I'm not going to ask you why you're here. Peggy, I think she's not a responsible person. And she doesn't know how to hold a job because she can't support her family, and that's why she's here. Well, that's a possibility. But there's also the possibility that her employer, folded and everybody got fired. Or maybe a coworker kind of did something and blamed her for it and got her fired. We don't know the reason. Now, you could ask Peggy directly, why are you homeless? And she would tell us, and don't worry, I'm not going to ask you, because then you would have to make up something. In any case, assuming she's a woman of integrity, we could believe what she said. Okay, this is what we do with God. We only see things by sight, but there's some things we can tell for sure. Okay, if you look at creation and you don't buy into the evolution lie, you know he exists, you know he's a designer, and he must be beautiful, and so on, and all these things, but we don't know, okay, well, why did he allow this tragedy? Or why did he do that? It just seems so unfair. Or how come so-and-so got it and I didn't, and I worked harder, and on it goes. We make assumptions. But God wants to tell us what he's like and how he works. Only he can really disclose to us the reason for certain things. And we might not never know here, but then this is where we often get into trouble, because we think God's like the best version of a human, you know, unerring, and but he's just like us. But God himself tells us in Psalm 50, thou thoughtest that I was altogether such as one as thyself. For I am God and not man, the Holy One in the midst of thee. Hosea 11:9. But God's not like us. God is the one who chooses to pull back the curtain to reveal what he's like. Any understanding we have about God is because he is the one who's given us the capability to understand and to recognize that was God. It's all him. We just get in on it. We cannot find the real God on our own. We cannot reach him. We cannot know him. That's what religion is, man's way of trying to know God. But true Christianity is God stooping down and disclosing the real deal. You see, mankind is sinful. We cannot come near a holy, pure God. We need a mediator. We need a go-between. We're dirty. We need to be clean. So the Old Testament law, if you read the Bible, what's this law stuff? It's just the Ten Commandments and a whole bunch of other things, okay? The Old Testament law was to show us that we're sinners and that we are in need of a Savior. That was the purpose. God knew we couldn't keep them. We need to know that. So then that way we'll turn to him and see our need of a Savior. We've broken the law, every single one of them. Every single one of us, we all fall short of God's perfection and righteousness. In other words, we're not right with God. But now, the righteousness of God, that's Jesus. The righteousness of God has been revealed apart from keeping the Ten Commandments. Romans 3:21 tells us that. And Titus 3:5 says, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us. And unlike our game show, there's nothing you can bring to trade to get to know the real God. There's nothing you can do. It's only by faith in Jesus Christ and what he did on the cross. He took your punishment and offered you free forgiveness. Free. Not free to him. Free to us. And by doing that, he gives us his righteousness, his holiness. I don't understand it. And it's okay. But somehow, when we say, yes, forgive me, I've sinned, he cleans us up and gives us his holiness. So we can now approach this pure, holy God the Father. Ephesians 2:8-9, many of you familiar with this. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. God is knowable, and that's the prize. The book I wrote, God is knowable. He is. But we must come to God his way. For there is no other way except through Jesus Christ. So what is our response to be to this wonderful revelation, to this unveiling of him, God? Well, we can choose to believe or reject. God has revealed enough about himself. We are without excuse, as it tells us in Romans 1. I used to be an atheist. I grew up in a mainline Christian home, but when I just didn't feel God. I didn't see God. And there was a whole bunch of hypocrisy, and so I went to college and eventually became an atheist because I bought into the evolution lie. And after I had been an atheist for, over 10 years at least, I began to question, suppose I'm wrong. Suppose there is a God. So one day I asked God, if you exist, I want to believe in you. Show me. And he did. For shortly after that, I heard the gospel and my eyes were opened. So you see, I had opened up my heart to the truth, and God opened my eyes to see the truth. Jesus. He was what I was looking for all my life. I said, yes, I'm so glad I did. Ladies, he is worth the knowing. If you question the existence of God, ask him. Seek him with an open heart. He can handle it. You know, choose curtain number 3. Look for him. He will show you because he says so in Jeremiah 29, 13 to 14, as I read early on. I will be found by you if you seek me with all your heart. You know, it's okay if you have doubts. God can handle it. Just go to him. Ask him. Ask him to give you understanding just enough to grasp what you need to grasp wherever you are. Whether you're not saved or whether you are and you're misunderstanding some truth about him. You want to believe that he's loving. You hear that he's loving, but how can this be? There's a contradiction. Go to him. Ask him. And he'll help you to accept it. He'll disclose the answer to you, or he'll give you peace about, like, it's okay. Because you know what, ladies? We're not going to understand everything there is to know about God ever. Not even throughout all of eternity in heaven when we continue to know him. There's always going to be a mystery surrounding our humongous, transcendent, totally other God. When I mean totally other, I mean not like us. You know, I have been saved for 32 years now. I still don't fully understand what happened on the cross. Do you understand gravity? Well, I don't want to throw that down. Well, all right. I don't understand gravity, do you? But we know it's true. We know it's true. Otherwise, you'd go walking off the roof of a 10-story building. We don't need to understand everything about the gospel. We don't have to understand everything about how God works. He doesn't disclose himself all at once. Do it little by little so we can understand. And we will continue to learn more and wonderful things about God all throughout eternity. Aren't you glad he's inexhaustible? Man, I sure am. I love learning something new about him or in a deeper way. And then when you do accept God and realize who he really is and how much he cares, you will respond in utter awe, love, and worship. Author Joseph Carroll says, the response to the true unveiling of the glory and majesty of God is always submission. Always. Why do people not submit to God? It's because they do not know him. For to know him is to immediately fall down in utter awe, love, praise, and submission. When we know him, we will respond in worship and obedience. And then you're not going to be able to keep quiet. You're going to want to shout it from the rooftops because you're going to be bursting full of praise and joy. You're not going to be able to keep it inside. I know I can't. You know, and then we're going to keep on seeking because it's this wonderful cycle. The more you know him, the more you want to know him, you will be ever hungering and thirsting after the Almighty, Awesome One. But at the same time, you'll be completely satisfied. It's a mystery. And all throughout eternity, more and more will know him. And then the more you find out about him, the greater the sense of his presence will be to you. You'll know without a shadow of a doubt he exists and that he loves you. You are the apple of his eye. You're precious. And more you will know that deep within. C.S. Lewis said, it is in the process of being worshipped that God communicates his presence to men. In conclusion, ladies, God wants to be known. Why? Why did he go through all that effort, even to the point of crucifying his son? Because he wants a love relationship with you. And he wants to get the glory that's due his name. Perhaps, though, the most important question I can ask you tonight is, does he know you? Not that you exist, but does he know you in a personal, intimate way? Can he truly say he knows you as one of his daughters, bought with the precious blood of his son? Let's pray.